Hello everyone, today I would like to talk to you about categorization, specifically categorization as it applies to vowel sounds. So what is categorization? Categorization is a ubiquitous aspect of how human beings think. Humans like to carve up the world into discrete categories, and we form these categories by our experiences, specifically by our real-world interactions with potential members that we might then put into different categories. We look for similarities and differences among things. The simplest example, of course, is the one of these things is not the same test, where all members of a set share a bunch of overlapping features, and the odd item out is somehow lacking in one of those features. The more familiar we are with things, the easier it is for us to categorize and classify them. Most educated people would be able to pick out the odd member of the set, including Icelandic, English, Norwegian, and Japanese, but it might take a linguist to pick out the odd member of the set that included Hindi, Spanish, French, and Basque. And finally, it might take a linguist with even more special training to pick out the odd member of the set, including English, Icelandic, Norwegian, and Danish. Experts tend to have different categories than non-experts do. Without learning that a bat isn't a bird, for example, there's no reason for us to think otherwise. They are things that fly. So let's look again at these languages, Hindi, Spanish, French, and Basque. To a linguist, we might see three Indo-European languages and one isolate. Basque is the odd item out to us. But to a non-linguist, there are three European languages, Spanish, French, and Basque, and one non-European language, Hindi. That's because experts and non-experts are drawing upon different features to make the classification. While it's easy to sit around as experts and think that our categories are somehow correct or true, they are no more or less real than those of a layperson. Furthermore, since people have a tendency to apply mental rules of thumb and exceptions and generalizations across entire categories, then we should really pay attention to how these categories are conceived of within the layperson's imagination. So, getting back to vowels. Well, what is a vowel? If you ask a layperson what a vowel is, there's a good chance they'll tell you that a vowel is A, E, I, O, U, and sometimes Y. But the expert definition that a linguist might come up with would be something like a speech sound that is produced by a comparatively open vocal tract with vibration of the vocal cords and not a lot of turbulence going on. Something that can host the nucleus of a syllable in a language. None of that would make any sense necessarily to a layperson. For experts like all of us, we tend to think of vowels very differently than regular people do. In fact, if I asked you to name the features of vowels, what makes one vowel different from another, you'd probably mention height, frontness, and rounding. These are the dimensions that we tend to recognize by experts. So if I play for you the sounds in the words boo, go, foot, and spa, you might come up with a categorization scheme based on one of these expert dimensions. What you would not come up with, however, is to say that spa is written with an A, whereas the others are written with an O. But that's what lay people often do come up with. So how does expert categorization impact research? Why does it matter that we've been paying attention to what experts think about categories rather than what lay people think? Many studies have shown evidence for the categorical perception of speech sounds. Typically, perception studies investigate categorical boundaries between precepts with closely related acoustical structures. We look at things like the F1 crossover point between kit and dress, or between dress and trap. But these findings have all started from a place of expert categorization. That is, we know where trap and dress cross over because they share all but one feature. Furthermore, by continuing to use expert classification, we've lost the ability to ask questions about primary versus secondary features of vowels. By using the features in expert categorization, we've come up with a lot. We've learned quite a bit. We've learned that discrimination is difficult within categories, but is easy between categories. We've learned that vowel perception is not continuous. We've learned that discrimination is not uniform across the continuum. That the free space to vary in is larger along the F2 dimension than it is along the F1 dimension. But we've also learned that research on the ground doesn't always conform to these expert categories. We talk about high back vowel fronting in the Germanic languages as if it's applying to a category without ever actually asking if humans, the people who are actually out there speaking and using these vowels, experience high back vowels as a category. So then my question is, how do non-experts categorize vowels? Without knowing the cognitive reality of categories, as naive listeners experience them, we're merely describing the data and not, per se, explaining it. So, How then do non-linguists categorize vowels? That's the question. In order to answer this question, I used a modified pile sort task, where 35 undergraduates at the University of Texas at Austin, and then later 25 undergraduates at San Diego State University, heard isolated spoken tokens of 14 vowels of American English. E, I, A, 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 etc. Listeners were then asked to group the vowels into two categories, three categories, four categories, and five categories, without any other label being applied. All listeners were previously familiar with the speaker who provided the data, which was me. None of the listeners had any previous formal expertise in linguistics, phonetics, or categorization. I didn't look at how listeners were grouped according to sex, class, or race, and that's because differences in categorization like this tend to correspond with different levels of experience with the stimuli set rather than with social differences. And it's assumed that if you're a college undergraduate without linguistic or phonetic training, that you probably had an equivalent level of access and experience with speech sounds. And for what it's worth, nearly all of the listeners that were participated in this task had had at least one foreign language class in high school. But foreign language classes don't tend to teach phonetic categories of vowels, so I don't see that as being a problem. Keeping this in mind, one problem that we can think about, however, is that this was me reading, or me speaking citation forms that they played over and over again on these little sound files. And because of that, when I produced the vowels, I stressed them in kind of odd ways, and I ended up being a lot more glidy than I probably otherwise should have been. Thought, for example, in the token set sounds like aw, aw, aw. So it's very much a weird way that I produced that vowel. I ran multidimensional scaling to determine what possible features people were using for categorization. And then I looked at the dissimilarity rankings to look at what were the most similar pairs of vowels and what were the least similar pairs of vowels. So, before we get to the results, I want you all to just take a minute and ask yourselves, if you were going to take these 14 vowels of American English and split them into two categories, what one single thing would you single out in order to make that distinction? Well, it turns out that lay people use a lot of different things. So I'm looking at the data from 60 respondents in total, but when you look at the individual data, things can be a bit messier. So for example, here are the ways that six of the listeners from my data grouped vowels according to two categories. And just by looking at these six visually, there's not really a whole lot similar going on. But when we look across the composite of all 60 respondents, patterns begin to emerge, and these patterns generate a kind of folk taxonomy of American English vowels. So starting with the factor groupings, we will look at the two-group categorization task. The two dimensions that popped out as the most important are ranked like this. And if you look at these for a minute, it seems to be that dimension one is asking how much does this sound change, not necessarily in terms of change in the vowel space, but also in terms of pitch and volume. So fleece, for example, is ranked up here with the more diphthongal vowels, even though we don't think of fleece as a diphthong. But when you say fleece, especially isolatedly, you tend to get a lot of variation in pitch and volume. E, E, that you don't necessarily get with foot. And then the second dimension seems to be asking, how much do my lips move? Not necessarily, again, whether or not this is a diphthong or not, but just, when you make this sound, are your lips loose and moving, or are they pretty much held in one position and maybe a little bit tighter? After looking at how lay people group these things, we can start to ask ourselves whether or not these approach or resemble our expert categories, but we shouldn't expect them to, nor should we try and shoehorn in a resemblance. As we move on from the two-category task to the three-category task, with more groupings come more dimensions that we can look at. However, we can't necessarily assume that groupings in the three-group task are going to be similar or related to groupings in the two-group task. For example, if you take this image and I ask you to split it into two groups, you'll probably split it into red and blue. But if I then ask you to split it into three groups, you'll probably split it into squares, circles, and triangles. That is, the responses that you give to the two-group task don't necessarily have anything to do with the responses you give to the three-group task. So thinking of that then, and moving on to three groups, this is what we see for the analysis of the three-group task. And again, trying to consider what these groups might mean, I'm thinking that dimension one looks like some kind of ranking of diphthongalness. Dimension two seems to be some kind of ranking of backness. And to me, dimension three seems to be the strangest one to look at, but then when you start to think about it in terms of a layperson, it seems to be ranking in terms of frontness of alphabet to backness of alphabet. When you look at the Latin alphabet, A, E, I, O, U, A and E are these letters that come at the front of the alphabet, O and U come at the back of the alphabet, and that seems to be how people are grouping this if we ignore whatever I is doing. And it's not just that I'm making this up. A lot of the respondents in their comment section wrote in that they used spelling in order to guide them in how to make these decisions. Moving on to the four grouping task, these are the dimensions that we see among the four grouping task. So the first dimension that we see is perhaps height, but more likely duration. The second one seems to correspond again to backness. The third one to diphthongalness. And the fourth one is a bit more difficult to figure out, but if we allow ourselves not to think in linguistic terms, then we might apply the label tenseness to it. How tense is your throat when you make these sounds? And then finally, the five grouping task. And again, these don't necessarily pop out as corresponding to any of the dimensions that we're used to thinking about. So we have to kind of get ourselves out of that headspace. And once we do that, so again, I'm thinking dimension one looks again like it might be related to the alphabet, AE at the top there, and things written with O and U down at the bottom, although not nearly as well as the first time we looked at that category, that option. The second one again does seem to be diphthongization. The fourth dimension seems to be backness, and the fifth dimension seems to be tenseness or laxness. This third dimension here in the middle, I, for the life of me, can't figure out what that is. Any suggestions are welcome. So that's one way of looking at these data. Another way we can look at the data, however, are to ask which pairs of vowels are ranked as most similar and which pairs of vowels are ranked as least similar. First off, when we look at things this way, monophthongs and diphthongs are always ranked as highly dissimilar. That, in fact, seems to be the number one thing that people pick up on. People have a lot of ways of talking about it. Some people say things that are written with two letters or things that are written with two different letters versus one letter, something like that. But they're picking up on this quality. Is this vowel a monophthong or a diphthong? This is super important to people. The second thing we notice when looking at similarity rankings is that lot and thought, which are merging in American English, are always ranked as the most similar vowel pair. And we expect that in the case of a merger. Other things that tend to go together are goose and goat, and fleece and face. We also find that the foot vowel and the strut vowel are highly similar, are ranked as highly similar. We'll come back to that in a minute. Finally, all of the vowels that are involved in these various shifts in North American English varieties, kit, dress, trap, lot, and strut, are always ranked as very highly similar. So, what does this tell us? Surprisingly, though there's some evidence for the psychological reality of traditional phonological dimensions when it comes to vowels, there's much stronger evidence in support of a new way of thinking about vowels, specifically Lebov's peripheral dichotomy for vowels. The non-peripheral vowels of kit, dress, trap, and strut are all highly similar in naive listener groupings. And what we're looking at now is the kind of egg-shaped model of the vowel space with the peripheral and non-peripheral tracts laid out from Lebov, Ash, and Boberg, 2006, from the Atlas of North American English. However, based on the data from the categorization task, I would say that since lot is also among the set that is considered highly similar to kit, dress, trap, and strut, while foot never is, we might want to revise the notion of what is a plus peripheral vowel and what is a minus peripheral vowel, so that from now on we might want to regard lot as being minus peripheral. Meanwhile, we have the foot vowel, which I'm not really sure what to do with. It is ranked as strongly dissimilar to goat and goose, to face and fleece, so we know that foot shouldn't be regarded as a peripheral vowel. But since it's never ranked among the top similarity pairs with any of the minus peripheral vowels, I'm not sure that we should necessarily put it there either. In fact, the only thing that foot really ranks similar to is strut. Can we then expect a strut-foot merger sometime in the near future? It's possible that we can, and in fact it's possible that this is already going on. So the U vowel in what Eckert describes as petulant drama princess speech often comes out as more of an uh sound. So in the phrase, put the book up, you get something like, put the buck up, or something like that. So how might we incorporate this research into what we already have, what we're already doing with vowels? Well, I would suggest the ways in which these naive groupings deviate from the categories of expert phoneticians can not only shed light on language change phenomena, but can also provide a principled benchmark from which future work on vowel categories can proceed. So, for example, listeners do not seem to attend to height as a dimension, nor do the similarity rankings give any evidence for height as being an important feature. So perhaps it's something that we can stop worrying about. Furthermore, the evidence from the categorization task seems to lend objective support, psychological support, to the post hoc construction of the plus or minus peripheral feature in Lebov and related work. We just might want to, based on these information, start tweaking that feature. That is, perhaps rather than paying attention to the old categories we have when it comes to vowels, we might instead start to think about vowels in terms of peripherality, movement, meaning something that combines tenseness with diphthongization, and backness. These seem to be the three features that people are picking up on. Additionally, we might therefore expect that vowels that can be grouped together under these features, rather than under the expert features that we've been using, might play a role in language change, might play a role in how we look at which vowels affect each other over the course of history, which vowels change together over the course of history. And that, in turn, might change the way that we do vowel methods. So, thank you.